Hi friends, welcome to our new live program, the 40-day program. Apologies for yesterday, we were not able to come on because there's a bereavement in the family and that affected everyone. Before I start at all today, I just want to give a few seconds in recognition of a member of our family who's just passed on. Okay, going forward, today is day 12 of our program, and like I said, we couldn't come on yesterday, but because we have made a commitment to come to you with this program, we just have to carry on. What do we have to talk about today? It's again something that we know it's here for a big message to all of us. So a quick reminder, what are we doing? We're actually reading this book, this exciting book called The Purpose Driven Life. So if you're coming live with us for the first time, this is what we're looking at, Purpose Driven Life. And it's by Rick Warren. And the question was, what on earth am I here for? This is a big question that I've always been very keen on. There's another interesting book called Man's Search for Meaning, and that's just me. I constantly search for meanings for things that are beyond us. And that's why when I was having a really rough time, things were really going out of sync with my regular life, I had to find a way to deal with it. And then I remembered this book, and I realized that I needed to read it. Now, I generally read so many books, which in the course of this program, I keep showing you the various books, similar things, spiritual things, motivational things, things that, you know, wake you up from whatever situation you find yourself in. And then while I was reading it, a voice came to me that there may be so many people out there who are going through tough times and they need to hear these similar kind of words to suit them and prepare them or encourage them to carry on. And that's why we decided to come to you, reading this book to you. And when I opened it, it turned out to be a 40 chapter book. And he said it's a 40 day program. So I took it upon myself to say, okay, I'm going to share this knowledge or this information for 40 whole days. So today is just day 12 and we're carrying on. We are excited about it. And so let's start today. So before I go into it, sometimes I have little notes and things I picked up from previous chapters that guide me to tell you about some things. And the notes is about what is really stopping some of us in life, what is stopping us progressing and moving on to the next stage. And it says, what stops most of us in life? Too much fear and worry. And this we experienced in the previous chapters. We worry too much about too many things and we are so afraid of too many things. And I'll give you a little example because I saw a message, we're live on YouTube, on Instagram, and we're live on Facebook. And you know, when you're on the social media, you come across so many things. And I know that there are so many people, one of the things we found out in this book is God gives all of us talents. And this amount of talents that we have is God's way of providing for us here on earth. And he wants us to use it to benefit both his kingdom and to benefit ourselves. But what happens is most of us lock these talents away and we don't use it. And one of the reasons that happen is because of fear and because of worry. And it hit me, when you are on this social media in various forms you find yourself, you're not going to meet everybody loving you. So lots of people go in there thinking it's going to be such an exciting, great world. Now remember, I've been doing this for some time and I've got an award for being on social media, so I should know what I'm talking about. And you start out really excited. I want to do this. You go on YouTube, you see people who are into makeup and who are, there's nothing you go on YouTube and search and you will not find. But what stops most people is the amount of hatred you can see sometimes. And you know, sometimes we call it haters. And so you will always be hated by a few or a group of people. This will always happen. And my advice to you is, if you find out you have an amazing talent, you have something that you want to share with the world, which is similar to what I'm doing right now. I know I want to share this book with you. I'm excited about sharing it with you. And then you see people who are going to come there with the most negative comments you can ever imagine. You get people who are so scared because they don't want to be told negative things. Now, unfortunately for you, there will always be people out there, no matter what you do, that will never be pleased with you. So I just want to encourage you from now onwards, never listen to whatever you're hearing that's so negative, that's aimed. The whole aim is to stop you from doing what you're doing. And so I call them, he said, no, you will always be hated by a few group of people, no matter how much you try. Even in real life, even in our daily life, there's always people who will hate you. There's always people who pretend to be your friends, and then we call them, I've heard people say frenemies. Frenemies are those you think are your friends, but they're actually your enemies. And what they do is they hang around you pretending to be friends, but trust me, when the listing happens, you will see their true color. These people exist in real life. So the whole idea is for you to be aware of this. And when you come across these people on social media, that should not stop you at all. If you have so much to share with the world, please go ahead and share it. Don't worry about the negativity. My advice is, be yourself. You cannot please these people no matter what you do. No matter what you do, you're not going to please everyone on the social media. Just like real life, you can never please everyone around you. The only way you can please them is to completely disappear from the surface of this earth. But unfortunately, what I'm saying is, continue to be yourself. No matter what, they did not create you, and your life is in the hands of your creator. That's the message we are getting from this book. Forgive, but learn lessons. And my meditation on this particular area, which we did talk about in the last chapter about meditation, which is listening to the word of God over and over, or thinking about it over and over. Meditation here is Luke chapter 23, verse 34. It says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Because these people who are picking on you for whatever reasons best known to them, they don't know where you're coming from. They don't know why you're doing what you do. So the best thing you can do is just remind yourself, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. And for me, what I do is I just send them love. Most times I just say, oh, thank you so much for the supportive statement. Thank you so much for the positive comment. Thank you so much. And I put hearts just to get them off my back. Because the minute they get these messages, they know that you're not in any mood to fight. And that's just what it should be. So that was it. And I said, wish them well and don't take it to heart. Okay, so that was that. Let's get into chapter 12 today. The title of chapter 12 is Developing Your Friendship with God. Remember, we started yesterday, and not yesterday, the day before yesterday, and we mentioned that there were six things you need to do to develop your friendship with God. So what are these six things? We talked about two in that previous chapter, and then there's four more in this chapter, and that's what we're going to be delving into today. So for us to start, we say he offers his friendship to the godly, and that's Proverbs chapter 3, verse 32. It says, draw close to God and God will draw close to you. So that's the big message here. Draw close to God and God will draw close to you. And that's in James chapter 4, verses 8. You are as close to God as you choose to be. Okay, so in between we do get technical issues. So some network may not be picking up and some may carry on. So whatever we are dealing with, we are actually behind the scenes working on them. So If you're not getting this, be patient, it's coming back on. So you are as close to God as you choose to be. So it's you who would choose to be close to God as much as you want to. Is it like any friendship? You must work at developing your friendship with God. And so remember, the whole purpose of this chapter is about developing your friendship with God. Like any friendship in life, you know, we just talked about friends and we're saying frenemies and enemies and all that. Anybody that you want to call your friend, you have to develop that friendship with the person. But here, God is asking us to develop friendship with Him. Friendship does not happen by accident. You have to cultivate it. So most of us think friendship happens by accident. You will call me, you know, I gave an example. So you just call somebody today and whatever you tell this person will jump and say, how high should I jump? And trust me, I've seen lots of people like that in my time. They are not in touch with you. They don't want to know anything about you. They have no idea what you're experiencing at any point in time. And then they just wake up from nowhere and they call you and they expect you to drop everything because they have a need. Now, that's not friendship. We take friendship for granted. And we complain when people don't jump at our beck and call. When you treat people badly, do not expect them to treat you great. That's a big message. So God is telling us today to develop that friendship with Him. And I gave an example. In marriage, husband and wife, it's about give and take. Whichever relationship you have, give and take. So in marriage, every person in that marriage, husband or wife, should expect a give and take scenario. Because in life, you reap what you sow. When you sow, you tend to this plant. So if you've ever been in the garden knowing how to plant a seed and you put the seed in the soil, the things you do is you water it, you care for it, you watch to see if there's weed coming and you take that weed away. That's what relationships need from all of us. So whatever relationships you have out there, you need to tend to it. And he says the same thing with friendship. You nurture it to grow it. This also happens with sisters and sisters. It happens with father and son. It happens with mother and daughter. It happens with clients in businesses as well. So when you have clients in your business, you take care of them and they take care of you. That's what they call give and take. Now God is reminding us to nurture the relationship we have with Him. He said, never ever take anyone for granted in life. Never take anyone for granted. And the book starts to explain. Friendships take desires. So you have to desire to be close to this person. You have to desire to want to know this person. And that's what God is asking of us. We should desire to know Him. Friendship takes time. So friendship is not something that just happens in an instant. And oh yeah, everybody is their friend. But when that friend is tested, you see how everything starts to fall apart. Maybe it's their birthday party and they're expecting this friend to come. The friend doesn't show up. Maybe something happened, this person, they didn't go to school and they come to school the next day and the friend doesn't even say, so what happened to you yesterday? So friendship slowly starts getting tested and then children slowly start to grow and they understand that this person they call their friend is not really what a friend should be. Here we've been told that friendship takes time. Friendship takes energy. So how much energy do you put into saying to it that this person and you have a good relationship? That's what God is expecting from us. Friendship takes care and love. So that's what they call friendship. We're trying to develop a friendship with God here. So if you want, and that started, affecting me. I started feeling unhappy or rather feeling down about people who you share everything you're thinking about with, and suddenly they don't want to say anything back to you. And they felt it's okay for them to just hear about you and not give back anything. And for me, again, you understand my feelings with marriage. It was a big thing for me because I share everything I want to do with my husband. And I found out that wasn't him. He's the kind of person that does not throw what he's thinking back at me. And recently, a big one happened to me where I'm saying to him, why are you not telling me the things you're feeling? Because you're very judgmental. Now, how do you think I feel about that? When you're told by someone that you open up to, that the reason they don't share things with you is because they think you're judgmental. But that's not what God wants from us. He wants us to openly tell him everything we feel. If I told you, you would judge it. Now that worries a lot of people. Because if you're dealing with people out there and they start having funny feelings about you because they think you're going to judge them, would you still carry on being open with these kind of people? That's something for you to worry about. How many people do you know that are keeping things away from you because they have reasons at the back of their mind why they cannot be honest with you? To these people, you are not meant to express your opinion about anything because they feel negative about what you're going to say. But how do you then create an honest friendship with this type of people? Now, this is different with God. With God, he wants us to express everything we feel with him. He wants us to thank him whenever we're happy. He wants us to tell him what we feel when things are not the way we want it to be. So we need to express ourselves to our God. And that's where this friendship thing is so important with God. So that was a big one. So now we're going further and further in. Remember, there were six things that we needed to do to show our friendship to God. And we did two in the last chapter. Now we're into this one. Number three. It says, I must choose to be honest with God. That's what this book is telling us. We must choose to be honest with God. Firstly, the first building block of a deeper relationship with God is complete honesty. And we're talking about human relationship too. If you want to have a relationship with anybody and you cannot be deeply honest with the person, do you have that relationship? About your faults, about your feelings, this is what God wants to hear from us. God does not expect us to be perfect. He wants complete honesty. God's friends in the Bible were not perfect. That's what this book is telling us. And he gives examples. Because of God's grace, Jesus is still friends of sinners like us. The book tells us that. In the Bible, friends of God were honest about their feelings. They were often complaining, second-guessing, accusing and arguing with their Creator. So whenever God gave them tasks to do, sometimes that has become a bit too much for them, they will actually tell God, you know what, I don't think you're being fair to me. He gave examples. God was not bothered about it. He actually encouraged it. God allowed Abraham to question him about the destruction of the city of Sodom. And he gave examples. He said, Abraham negotiated and pestered God down from 50 to only 10 righteous people. So if you remember this story, God was fed up with Sodom and Gomorrah, I think it was. And God said he was going to destroy the city. And Abraham kept saying, but God, what if I get into that city and I find X number of people who are righteous? God said, okay, if you find that number of people, I will not destroy the city. Abraham will go down again. But God, what if I find X number of people who are righteous? Would you still destroy the city? No, I will not. And so he carried on until they got to 10 people. 10 people were the only people that were righteous in the city. And that was how much God allows us to negotiate with him sometimes if we think what's happening is not happening right. He said, God listened patiently to David's many accusations of unfairness. So David kept accusing God of being unfair to him. He kept accusing God of betraying him and abandonment. He did not slay Jeremiah when he claimed that God had tricked him. And so these are stories in the Bible. He's explained that these are God's friends in the Bible that really did argue with God, and God did not get upset with them because he actually wants to see truly who they are. And what he's trying to explain to us here is the fact that none of us are perfect. So when you have friendship with people who automatically start telling you you're judgmental and you're not being right and you're not being this and you're not being that, they're just expecting you to be perfect. And he's saying, no, God does not expect us to be perfect. But God still wants us to be very genuine with him. Wants us to be honest with him. He said, Job, was allowed to vent his bitterness during his ordeal, and in the end, God defended Job for being honest, and he rebuked Job's friends for being inauthentic. So God told them, you haven't been honest either with me or about me, not the way my friend Job has been. My friend Job will now pray for you and I will accept his prayer. So again, this is another example where Job was being really honest with God. He said, God, you've not been fair to me. You allow me to go through all of this. And God, instead of being angry with Job, God was happy with Job and told Job's friends off that they weren't being fair and they weren't being honest with him. In another example, God honestly expressed his total disgust with Israel's disobedience. He told Moses he would keep his promise to give the Israelites the promised land, but he wasn't going one step further with them in the desert. God was fed up, and he let Moses know exactly how he felt. Hear Moses' response to God. Moses, speaking as a friend, also responded with equal candor. Look, you tell me to lead these people, but you don't let me know. You don't let me know whom you are going to send with me. If I'm so special to you, let me in on your plans. Don't forget, this is your people, your responsibility. If your presence doesn't take the lead here, call this trip off right now. How else will I know that you are with me in this? With me and your people? Are you traveling with us or not? So this is Moses responding back to God. All of this is in the Bible. Moses did not sit down and allow God to say, you know what, I'm not going to go one more step with you guys in the desert. That's it, I'm done. Moses replied, you sent me to go and lead these people. These are your people. If you think you're not going to come with us, let us know, because you told me to do this. And so he expressed how he felt to God. And so that's what God wants from us. God said to Moses, all right, after Moses had expressed how he felt. All right, Moses, just as you say, this also I will do, for I know you well and you are special to me. God said that to Moses. Again, that's another mind-blowing moment. This is our God. He talks. He lets us know how he feels. And then he wants us to let him know how we feel. God that listens, that responds, that hears what we say and analyzes it and relates to our emotions and feelings. This is the God I love and serve and hope you do too. So can God handle that kind of frank, intense honesty from us? Yes. This man in the book is asking us. He said, absolutely. Genuine friendship is built on disclosure. And again, that's another thing we humans need to take on board. When we tell ourselves that we have friends, we have married, we have relatives, we need to be honest with each other. That's the big message here. This explains to me that most of us have no idea what friendship means. And this is me talking. Because we don't disclose anything to each other. We just take each other for granted. And this passage, this chapter, really, really hones in the message. What may appear as audacity, God views it as authenticity. So, how many of us are honest enough to confront each other as friends, or as husband and wife, or as mother and daughter, or as father and son, and say, this is what I think. And then the other person is ready to sit down and listen and say, okay, I take it on board. Talking about friendship here, we're talking about how we create a relationship with God and our fellow man. He is bored with predictable, pious cliches. So when it's so clear that, oh yeah, I know what she's like, that's not what it should be. Because then you become predictable. It's like you just know what this person is going to say. We don't all want lame, basic, boring people around us. God wants you to have emotions. God wants you to tell him how you feel about something. So to be God's friend, we must learn to be honest to God, sharing our true feelings, not what you think you ought to feel or say. So that's the same thing with us humans. You know, like with kids, most times you say to a child, how are you feeling? Fine. But you know that they're not fine. Something is not right. You could feel it. How are you feeling? Fine. So that's the kind of thing we're talking about. We need to be honest. This says a lot in relationships, and we've talked about it. Parents with children, sisters and sisters, husband and wife, friends and friends. It is likely that we need to confess some hidden anger and resentment at God for certain areas of our lives where we have felt cheated or disappointed. So this is us going through a life, and just like we read in the Bible now about friends of God, how whenever things really got out of hand, they just said, you know what, I'm not going to keep this one to myself anymore. God, I feel this way about this. And then they air out how they feel. So that's what it should be like. We should be able to talk, to express how we feel. And I think the same thing applies to our relationships here on earth as well. So for me, like I keep telling you, one of the big things that I've had to sit with my God to talk about expressing how I feel is the training that I offer here. The training with Hair Business, which is this home training pack. And this is something that we created when we had inquiries from all over the world, people telling us they would have wanted to train, they needed to have this skill, but the reason they're not doing it is because we're so far away, and the cost of transportation, the cost of the hotel, the cost of leaving their family. So we took that on and created this amazing program. What then happened? Few people are interested. Now every excuse under the sun is being thrown at us. And the only reason I haven't got it is because. The only reason so you get all these excuses. And I remember what pushed me into this. I lost my corporate job working in the city and everything when I have 4 children. And I thought, if I have a skill in my hands, it will help me. It will make my life a bit better. And so I took that on. And after I did it, and it worked for me. It worked for me. I could relate to my clients, and I had clients growing, and I was so excited about it. And I thought, let me share this with other people. And that's what made me start training people with hair. But what do I get today? Laid back people, people who are not interested, people who rather put their money into other things than a skill that will be theirs for life. Now, several times I tell you, I've had to sit with God, and I said, Father, talk to me. Because I took on this role that you asked me to do. Go and share this knowledge with other women. Help them get better at something. Remember we said in a few chapters, God flows through us. God flows through us, through the talents he's given us, through the skills he's given us, through the knowledge he's given us, through the information, through the experiences that we go through. And this is why I constantly share my experience here. Because I know that my experience and things I've been able to overcome, you may be going through it and you need someone to guide you through it. And I tell you the most interesting part, we black people in particular, we struggle with sharing our experiences, especially personal experiences. Like I tell you things that I'm experiencing. For me, the minute I say it, I feel healed. I feel good. It's over. It's done. But if I bottle it inside, it eats me up. And that's why I share. But people think, let me hold you until the day I die. I take that message, I take that knowledge back to my creator. That's not how it should be. And so when I'm sharing the skill I have, and people are laid back at investing in it, because what I tend to get here is people just want me to share my knowledge, especially with skill that I know is going to empower you, give you more skills. You want me to just give it to you free. And I struggle with that. Because how else would I pay the bills that I have to deal with? How else should I feed my family? It's a give and take scenario. Friendship. You need to give something and I give something. And that's just the way it is. But that's the reality of our times. And I have had to speak to my God to find out what it is that's causing this kind of problem. But that's just the way it is. So when you have anything really bothering you like that, you have to open up to God and say, talk to me, guide me. And trust me, I have so much guidance right now. The other thing I struggle with a lot too is, I've talked about it many times, understanding marriage. Marriage has been a big job for me. And I've talked about this over and over. But again, there are lots of people out there who are struggling with understanding marriage too. And it's affecting them in their so many everyday life. I have so many people I know that are struggling to cope with marriage. If that happens to be your issue, also take it to God. Open up to Him and tell Him exactly how you feel about it. But that's just the way it is. We need to open up ourselves to say, Father, talk to me. Guide me in this scenario. So, the focus here is to help us develop a new life. Unless we mature enough to understand that God uses everything for good in our lives, we have our resentment. That's what they're trying to tell us here. We have our resentment towards God over our appearance, people do, over our background, people do, over our unanswered prayers, people do, over our past hurt. So anything that hurt us in the past, we're harboring resentment. Over any minutest thing, I hear people all the time, if there's really God, why is this happening in my life? If there's really God, why isn't it this way? But we don't speak to Him directly. No, we want to speak to other people. If there's really God, why is this? These people are not going to answer you. They're not God. So God wants you to create a friendship with Him where you can open up to Him just like His friends in the Bible did. Most times we blame God for hurts caused by other people. When other people hurt us, we still turn around, we go and blame God. This creates what William Backus calls your hidden rift with God. So there's a man called William Backus, and he called it your hidden rift with God. Bitterness is the greatest barrier to friendship with God. Remember, God always acts in your best interest, even when it is painful and you don't understand it. So he's trying to explain to us that we being God's friends, whenever things are happening that we don't understand, there's a reason for it. There's a reason for it. And it's only when we are really in true friendship with God that we will understand these things. Releasing your resentment and revealing your feelings is the first step towards healing. So very important, you need to understand that. So holding those things in your heart and creating hurt and pain and all of that doesn't help. It actually destroys you. So you have to, like God's friends in the Bible, tell God exactly how you feel. This is what the book is advising us to do. To instruct us in candid honesty, God gave us the book of Psalms. So this is one of the things He's telling us to do. It is a worship manual, the book of Psalms in the Bible. It's full of ranting, it's full of raving, it's full of doubts, it's full of fears, it's full of resentment. So when you take your time, read through the book of Psalms, it says you're going to see all these emotions. But yet you also see deep passion. You see combined, deep passion that's combined with thanksgiving. You're going to see praise. You're going to see statements of faith. Every possible emotion is in the book of Psalms. So he's telling us that this is what God wants from us. To be able to express exactly how we feel at different points in time. God wants us to worship him by holding back nothing. So when you become someone's friend, this is what you should be thinking about. Holding back nothing. Being free to express how you feel to that person. Like David, I pour out my complaints before him and tell him all my troubles. For I am overwhelmed. That's what David said. It is encouraging to know that all of God's closest friends, Moses, David, Abraham, Job, etc., had bouts with doubt. So they were not completely sitting down there every day, all was well. No, that's not how life should be. So instead of masking their misgivings with pious cliches, they candidly voice them openly and publicly with God. So that's the kind of friendship He wants us to create with our Creator. Expressing doubt is sometimes the first step towards the next level of intimacy with God. It reminds me of a saying. This is me saying this. When you're dealing with customer service, he says, if we please you, so most businesses will say to you, if we please you, tell others. If we don't, tell us. So if you find out you're not happy, things are not going right, it's not for you to hop around on the streets and telling people, look at what God has done to me. You should be telling God. And when you're happy, you tell him thank you, but you also tell others. And I hear it all the time, and I say mine all the time. I know amazing times and all the amazing things God has done for me. That's what it should be. You should remember to thank him when you're happy with him. And you also remember to say, God, this one I'm not happy about. But you just have to learn to be very clear and clean and intimate with him. So if God has pleased you, tell others and thank him. If he has not pleased you, tell him rather than hold a grudge, which lots of people do, holding grudge against God. So number four, he says, I must choose to obey God in faith. So we must choose to obey God in faith. He says, every time we trust God's wisdom and do whatever he says, even when we don't understand it, you deepen your friendship with God. So trusting God allows you to deepen your friendship with him. We don't normally think obedience is a characteristic of friendship, but it is. It is. He said we think that is reserved for relationship with a parent or with a boss or with a superior officer. When you're being obedient, you think it's only when you're dealing with a superior officer that you should be obedient. But no, obedience is a characteristic of friendship. Your friend tells you something, you listen. He said Jesus made it clear that obedience is a condition of intimacy with God. He said, you are my friends if you do what I command. Jesus said that to us. We are friends with God, but we are not his equal. We are friends. He wants us to be his friends, but we are not equal to him. He is our loving father. He is our leader, and we follow him. We obey God not out of duty, fear, or compulsion, but because we love him and trust him, that he knows what is best for us. That's why we obey God, because we know he knows what's best for us. We want to follow Christ out of gratitude for all he has done for us. And the closer we follow him, the deeper our friendship becomes. Unbelievers often think Christians obey out of obligation, guilt, or fear of punishment. But this is not the case. This is the opposite. We obey because we love God. Because we have been forgiven and set free, we obey out of love, appreciation, and obedience. And this obedience brings great joy in our life. Because we obey God, we are excited. Jesus said, I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. Remain in my love. When you obey me, you remain in my love. Just as I obey my Father and remain in his love. I have loved you this so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. So that's Jesus talking to us. So the minute we obey him, eventually our joy will overflow. Remember, Jesus did whatever the Father asked him to do out of love. He sacrificed himself for us. Out of obedience, he obeyed. True friendship isn't passive, it is active. When Jesus asks us to love others, help the needy, share our resources and knowledge, keep our lives clean, offer forgiveness, and bring others to love, to his love, what motivates us is love to obey immediately. So whenever Jesus tells us to do things, and we do it, it's out of love to obey. Reality is, God is more pleased when we do small things for him out of loving obedience. No matter how small, we lovingly obey. Most of us think it's until we do great things. God is quite happy when we do the smallest things too. They may be unnoticed by others, but God notices them as acts of worship. Great opportunities may appear once in a lifetime, but small opportunities surround us daily. So every little thing we do for God adds up. God is happy with it. Telling the truth is a good example. Being kind to people, encouraging others. These are all the little things that God wants us to do. That shows we obey Him. That shows we love Him. These acts bring a smile to God. God treasures simple acts of obedience more than prayers, praise, or offerings. Because lots of us think it's until we offer offerings. That's when God is happy with us. Bible says, what pleases the Lord more? Burnt offerings and sacrifices or obedience to His voice? And the Bible says, it is better to obey than to sacrifice. He explains, Jesus started His ministry at the age of 30 after being baptized by John the Baptist. God spoke from heaven, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. What did Jesus do before He was 30? Says the Bible didn't really tell us much about that. But there is a small phrase in Luke chapter 2 verse 51. He went back to Nazareth with them and lived obediently with them. So that word obediently was really something that we needed to know about. 30 years of living obediently, now that was what pleased God so much, because He lived obediently. So number 5, we're still looking at things that bring us closer to God. He says, I must choose to value what God values. That's a big one again for us. Friends value what each other values. They care about what is important to the other person. That's what friends do. Now, this is a very good example because I remember a book. No, not a book. I was watching this YouTube channel, Bob Proctor. And one of the things he really talked about that really touched me is this law of motion and energy vibration. And that really did something to me because I learned a lot from that message he gave. Energy vibration. Now, all of us as humans, from the minutest cell in our body, is constantly in motion. We are constantly in motion. And it turns out, obviously, you know, the world is constantly in motion as well. It turns out that at every point in time, we are in motion going somewhere. Even when we are sleeping, we are in motion. Now, this is what you're going to find. Because we are all vibrating towards something, we're going somewhere at every point in time. This is where it starts to get interesting. The people you hang around are vibrating towards the same way that you are vibrating. And that's why you feel comfortable in their midst. That's why you're comfortable in the midst of the people you hang around with. It gets interesting when you happen to be in the midst of somebody who is not vibrating towards the way you are vibrating. And you know what then happens? They call it negative energy. Because at this stage, you are going this way, that person is going that way. So you are now at friction. And that's when it starts to go bad. Because suddenly, you become uncomfortable in their midst. And he gave an example. He said, have you ever walked into a restaurant and you suddenly feel something? He says, the energy in that place is not going the way you are going. And this you're going to find sometimes in most marriages. I keep coming back to marriage. If you find you are going this way and your husband is going that way, there's a problem. The energy is not flowing in the same direction. And that's why you see most marriages are breaking up so easily. Because what happens is, both parties are not going the same direction. So it's something you need to watch out for. The minute you start seeing these things happening, be very careful. One party wants to make money, the other party wants to spend it all. The other party wants to build a loving home, the other party wants to have a fight all the time. One party is satisfied with a home life and the other party wants to be out there constantly. We need to be aware of that. And it's not just marriage, it's in any relationship. You find your friends are quite happy to hang out and have so much to drink, and you don't want to drink. You call them your friend. So you're going to find that the minute this relationship is not vibrating towards the same direction, friction starts to happen. Things start to go wrong. We're just talking about being open with each other. If you happen to be in a relationship where one party is opening up all the time, the other party wants to hold back everything, friction starts to happen. And that's where the energy is not vibrating towards the same direction. And so here God is saying to us, this man is saying to us, we must choose to value what God values. Okay, so we just got a question here. Is it better to be obedient than to sacrifice? God says it is better to be obedient. The Bible says it. It says it is better to obey than to sacrifice. Thank you so much for that question. It is better to obey God than to sacrifice. Thank you so much for the question. It shows that we are getting some interaction at last. So the more you become God's friend, the more you care about what He cares about. And that's why we just explained the energy vibration. So if you're vibrating towards where God wants you to vibrate towards, where God is going, which is positive, happy, loving, kind, being honest, being truthful, you find that you will not struggle giving God what He wants from you. But the minute you are negative, you are against that, your energy is not going the same direction. And that's when you struggle. And so grief over, what he was saying was, the more you become God's friend, the more you care about what He cares about. The more you grieve over the things He grieves about. The more you rejoice over the things He rejoices about. And all these things bring God pleasure. God's agenda was Paul's agenda. God's passion was Paul's passion. The things that has me, and this is Paul speaking now, the thing that has me so upset is that I care about you so much. This is the passion of God burning inside me. That's how much Paul cared about God. He had so much passion burning inside him. David felt the same way about God as well. Passion for your house burns within me. This is David talking. He said, so those who insult you are insulting me. And David said that. So what does God care about most? We need to know what God cares about most. Redemption of His people. He wants His lost children found. This is the main reason Jesus came to the earth. To be a friend of God, you must care about all the people around you whom God cares about. So that's a big one now. We are in a world full of people, and we need to get the message that God created all of us. So we need to care about people. There's a passage in Ecclesiastes that says, one of the biggest things we have to do as humans is work hard, give to charity, and enjoy ourselves. That's our biggest task on this earth. We need to work hard, give to charity, and care about, you know, have fun, enjoy ourselves. Because that's it. The minute we don't do that, you know what it says as well? Dust to dust. Before you know it, it is over. It clearly says in Psalms as well, longest we live is 70. Not just 70. It says when our body can carry us, we get to 80. And in this book, it said to us, we may get to 100. Yes, there are people who get to 100. But it's very rare. And so if this is what it is, and we just want to go stay here and struggle and struggle and struggle, we'll struggle and end up nowhere. So he says we have to work hard, yes, but we also must have fun. But we should also remember to care about people who don't have. And that's what he's telling us here. Redemption of his people. He wants his lost children found. This is the main reason Jesus came to earth. To be a friend of God, you must care about all the people around you whom God cares about. Friends of God tell their friends about God. So remember what we said earlier, If you found that God has done an amazing thing for you, remember to share it with the world. Remember to tell people, look at all the amazing things that God has done for me. He's protected my children. He's taking care of all my needs. I can wake up and breathe. I have two hands. I have all the senses working. I wake up every day seeing light. So these are amazing things. Because like we said earlier, that's how short life is. Before you know it, it's over. So why don't you make the best of this life? So, number six. Remember we said this whole thing ends at six. Being knowing what God wants from us. I must desire friendship with God more than anything else. So we apologize for Facebook because I think that has just packed up on us. Oh, are we fine with Facebook? We are fine? All right, sorry. I thought we were down on Facebook. So we're carrying on. Number six. I must desire friendship with God more than anything else. And he comes down to explain it. Psalms has this example of desire more than any other book. We must desire. Remember we said it earlier. Desire is the word we're looking for here. We must desire friendship with God more than anything else. And we said it earlier, if you want to have friendship with anyone, you have to desire it. You don't just sit there and expect people to hop around you and be your friend. You wish for it. You ask for it. You seek it. So, Psalms has this example more than every other passage in the Bible. David passionately desired to know God above all else. So, David chose that. He used words like longing, yearning, thirsty, hungry, and he craved God and said, "The thing I seek most of all is the privilege of meditating in his temple." David said that. He just wants to meditate. Every time he gets the opportunity to meditate in the temple of God, that's what he cares about most. Living in his presence every day of my life, delighting in his incomparable perfection and glory. So David is praising and praising God. In another psalm he said, "Your love means more than life to me." David was saying this to God. Jacob's passion for God's blessing on his life was so intense that he wrestled all night with God saying, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So this is another passage in the Bible where Jacob actually wrestled with God. Say, "I'm not going to let you go until you bless me." That's how much he desired God's friendship. God, who is all powerful, let Jacob win that wrestling match. Requires personal contact and brings us close to God. So whenever we are having this close contact with God, God loves it. He loves it because he knows that you are passionate about him. So God loves it when we are passionate with him. Paul was another passionately friendly person with God. Nothing mattered more. He was the first priority, total focus, and ultimate goal of his life. This is the reason God used Paul in such a great way. So Paul was one of those people who was really, really used by God. My determined purpose is that I may know him, that I may progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with him, perceiving and recognizing and understanding the wonders of his person more strongly and more clearly. Saying this. Okay, so we're done now on one of the media. We're done on Instagram. Apologies. Truth is, you are as close to God as you choose to be. Intimate friendship with God is a choice, not an accident. So God's friendship is not an accident. God, you don't just happen to be friends with God. You have to choose it. And that is so important for us to note. You have to choose to be God's friend. You have to choose to be intimate with him. We just said intimate friendship with God is a choice, not an accident. So if you just joined us again on Instagram, that's what we just read. Intimate friendship with God is a choice, not an accident. So we want you to remember to choose to be God's friend. It doesn't just happen by accident. He said you must intentionally seek God. Intentionally wake up every morning and ask God to guide you. Wake up every morning and speak to God. Remember in the last chapter we talked about all those short phrases that brings God's presence next to you. Do you want it more than anything else in the world? That's the question he's asking us. What is it worth to you? Is it worth giving up other things? I said it is worth it, because I had to give up everything else I was doing in order to read this book to you. So it's worth it, because I'm learning so much out of it. I'm gaining so much understanding. I'm getting a bigger message out of this. And I'm hoping that you're getting the same too from this. It is worth it. What pleasure is God getting out of my life? That is a big question we need to keep asking ourselves all the time. And when I can do something like this, I feel good, because I feel there's a pleasure God is getting out of me. He's been able to flow through me to chat this with you. Is it worth the effort of developing the habits and skills required for God? Yes, it is. You may have been passionate about God in the past, but lost the desire to be there with God. If you've just been going through the motions spiritually, don't be surprised when God allows pain into your life. So if you walk with God and all you do is just, for the sake of it, you're just there hanging around and thinking you're doing something, sometimes things will completely go wrong. And when it goes wrong, that's when you wake up again. And I think I'm a good example of that. I was otherwise hopping along and marching along and trotting along with life until things, I started feeling this overwhelming pain in my heart where things were not going the way I was hoping they should go. And that's when the desire came in again to quickly talk to God and let him talk back to me. And that's when this book came. And now things are opening up again to me. So pain is a fuel of passion. It energizes us with an intensity to change that we don't normally possess. So normally we probably think, oh yeah, everything is going okay. And that's why we call it a new life. And that's why Eckhart Tolle calls it a new awakening. Because you suddenly realize, or rather he calls it a new earth. Create a better life, a new earth. You suddenly realize that what's happening in my life is not that great. I need to do something about it. So you need to wake up. If you've been sleeping and think, oh yeah, everything is trotting okay, life is fine, something will happen that will wake you up. And that's what creates that passion again. And it says, C.S. Lewis explained, pain is God's megaphone. Wow, that is a big one. It is God's way of arousing us from spiritual lethargy. So when things really hit you hard, you wake up. You suddenly realize that, oh my goodness, what have I been doing? And it comes in so many ways. It comes in so many ways. With Eckhart Tolle, he suddenly realized that, he said to himself, I can no longer live with myself. He wanted to kill himself. We're not hoping that any of us will get to that stage. But if you find things are not working the way you're really hoping for, and that's why I happily tell you my experiences when things are not happening, and I share it with you. Whatever it is that's happening to you right now, and it's not what you're looking for, it's a message for you to go back to your Creator. It's a message for you to wake up and deal with it and face God and talk to Him. You've heard the messages here of all various friends of God telling you things. And they were having this intimate interaction with God and telling him how they feel. I mean, when I read that passage about Moses talking to God and telling God, really, you're either going with us or not, I thought, wow, I never thought of that. That I could actually tell God how I feel about something. So that's a big message today. You really need to start talking to God. God is not mad at us. He is mad about us. That is how much he loves us. He will do whatever it takes to bring us back into fellowship with him. Because he created us. He owns us. So he always wants us back. Start asking God to give it to you. Keep asking until you have it. Pray throughout the day. Ask Jesus daily. Dear Jesus, more than anything else, I want to get to know you intimately. God told the captives in Babylon, when you get serious about finding me and want it more than anything else, I'll make sure you won't be disappointed. So that was God talking to these people in Babylon. He said, when you get serious about finding me, so that's the message to all of us today. When you get serious about finding God, and you want it more than anything else, he said, I'll make sure you won't be disappointed. It's a big message for me. And I have got that message. Coming to you with this book has also opened up my understanding more and more about God and how much he loves us. And so he goes further to explain this for us. He says, your most important relationship, there is nothing, absolutely nothing, than developing a friendship with God. It's a relationship that will last forever. Paul told Timothy, some of these people have missed the most important thing in life. They don't know God. Remember, it is your choice. You are as close to God as you choose to be. That's a big message here. And so, in the last chapter, we were talking about meditation all the time. And normally we finish with a question. It says, what practical choices will I make today in order to grow closer to God? So that's your question to yourself now. What practical choices will I make today in order to grow closer to God? And for meditation, I chose this. 1 John chapter 3, verse 3. All those who have hope in him purify themselves. So that's what you need to be saying to yourself over and over. If you have hope in God, you're going to purify yourself. So we're going to stop here today. That's chapter 12 done. And so the chapters are getting longer and longer. If you ask me sometimes, I'll say, let me cut it short. But if I do that, that means our days will grow longer. So we want to just stay with the 40 days and not make it any shorter, any longer than it should be. So I say thank you so much to everyone who watched and followed us to the end. We thank you because it shows that you are as keen on this as we are. So we look forward to seeing you tomorrow by God's grace, because it's only by his grace we're here. And God bless you eternally.